I want to say a few words to you about the person of Al-Abbas, half brother to Al-Hussein. And he's certainly a person who is exceptionally well known to those listening and exceptionally well known and greatly revered in the, especially in the Shi'i Islamic world. So what I'm going to be saying tonight perhaps is not going to be new information about Al-Abbas as much as my own reflections, as over the last 3 or 4 years, I've tried to prepare a biography, an academic biography of his life, and his, and especially the most important moments of his life. And I have come across, as I've worked, I've come across interesting facets of his life, which I would share among you tonight. The incalculable popularity of Al-Abbas among all Shia devotees is huge, and it's in no way lessened by the fact that the truth is there's very little academic work written about Al-Abbas. There are lots of little booklets and pamphlets, especially about his heroic behavior at Karbala, but academic work about him, those works are very few. And the reason they're very few is because there are very few resources. There is very little about Al-Abbas in the primary Arabic, Shi'i, and even Sunni texts, besides some of the historians. And so the absence of books about Al-Abbas and information about Al-Abbas means that any biography is always going to be a biography in fragments. And there are going to be gaps which we are unable to fill, except perhaps with pious thoughts that we create around his life, simply because we don't have a record, as full a record as we would like, of his life. But the most important moments of Al-Abbas's life are consistently retold and reenacted in a number of what I call Shi'i liturgical settings, that is, the ta'ziyah and in the majalis traditions. And these two moments, especially, he becomes this iconic figure, almost an archetype for us. And like so many of the historical personalities who are gathered around Al-Hussein and around his martyrdom at this moment, he has a story, Al-Abbas, that I believe as a Westerner and a non-Muslim is worth telling. And it's worth telling more widely to a much bigger audience because he is barely known in the West, except for a few, again, archetypal moments in his life. I would say that Al-Hussein and his brother Al-Abbas live in a sort of virtuous circle. They are inseparable. In a sense, they nurture and fuel each other's lives and martyrdoms. Al-Abbas is really, besides being his brother, he is Al-Hussein's champion, his bodyguard, his standard bearer, his diplomat, entrusted with these missions of diplomacy, most of which are quite hazardous. At the end of Al-Abbas's life, when finally he is killed, Al-Hussein cries out, "My back has been broken." This is his anguish at the death of his half-brother, and it's a lament that is carried, puzzlingly for me, by very few transmitters. My means, my ability now, says Hussein at the death of Al-Abbas, is diminished. But the trouble is, Al-Abbas for us is a very elusive, hidden figure. He hides behind Al-Hussein. He doesn't wish to draw any attention to himself. And he is also a man of very few words, although when he has to speak, he is almost always the first to speak before anybody else. You had at the Battle of Karbala roughly 70 companions and family members who stood shoulder to shoulder with Al-Hussein and died there, defending not just Al-Hussein, but the cause of Al-Hussein. About 20 of those 70 were actual members of the Ahl Bayt, members of Al-Hussein's family. But his brother Al-Abbas receives far more attention than almost all of the others in the sources, even though there is very little in the sources. And almost more than any of the others, his character and his personality, which are shaped by his actions around the Battle of Karbala, are further fashioned and further shaped by subsequent readings and enactments down through the generations. He is a diplomat and he is a negotiator. He is a banner or a standard carrier. He is the one who goes searching for the most necessary thing of all, and that is water. He is a model of absolute selflessness, the last man standing. And he becomes, as a number of authors note, he becomes the icon of an unwavering family support for al-Hussein. And he becomes the anti-model of all of those who took up arms against al-Hussein or betrayed his cause. For those people, al-Abbas is the anti-model. Now, his story, the borders and the boundaries of his story are quite well known. He is one of four brothers. He has three blood brothers. He is a son of Ali bin Abi Talib, not by Ali's first wife, the Lady Fatima, daughter of the Prophet, but by a later spouse who, in fact, was also called Fatima, although she is rarely ever called by that name. And she herself, al-Banin, would win immense fame and devotion throughout Islamic history and in Islamic piety. The early life of al-Abbas, as he grows up, like so many people of that very distinct era of Arabic and Islamic history, is very badly recorded. We are told, for example, by some scholars that he fought at the Battle of Siffin. No matter how much you try to juggle the dates, it seems distinctly unlikely that al-Abbas was actually fighting on that day. He may well have been present, but almost certainly, and we have texts that tell us this, he was confused with a fighter by another fighter by the same name. He's a child of Ali, but not of Lady Fatima, which means he doesn't share with his brothers al-Hassan and al-Hussein in the imamate and in all of the supernatural gifts and bestowals of the imamate. But he still gives his life in a determined defense of al-Hussein, the man who represents for him that very sacrosanct institution, no matter how much in those very early opening years al-Abbas may have understood it. One of the scholars that I used chiefly, really, for trying to fathom his life was, of course, al-Sheikh al-Mufid. In his book of guidance, Kitab al-Irshad, Mufid relates six or seven very distinct moments about al-Abbas, specifically around the Battle of Karbala. And therefore, he provides us with some sort of chronology, if you like, for at least the circumstances that lead to the death of al-Abbas at the battle. But his chronicle is not always in tune with the chronicles that other historians give, such as At-Tabari and before him the famous Abu Mihnaf. And sometimes al-Mufid's sequence of events differs from the sequence of events that we have in the famous Maqatil works from which the story is related. Mufid also, Sheikh al-Mufid also omits a number of things, which is for me a bit of a puzzle. And he emphasizes things differently and his timing is different. Nonetheless, he does, although it's not a very extensive framework, he does give us a framework for al-Abbas's battlefield moments. And therefore, al-Mufid's account is of great interest to any scholar. He was himself, al-Mufid, a prolific and a highly reputable Shi'i jurist and theologian. And yet again, curiously, a number of al-Abbas's actions at Karbala are missing from al-Mufid's account. And this is a very difficult factor for us to get our heads around. They are narrated by a much earlier scholar, Abu Mihnaf, and then they seem to disappear. But let's look briefly at these moments of al-Abbas taken from al-Mufid. The first moment that al-Mufid records is that al-Abbas and his three half-brothers, his three full brothers, that is Abdullah, Jaffa, and Uthman, all sons of Ali bin Abu Talib, they receive a double offer of indemnity, of safe conduct off the battlefield. One comes from Ibn Ziyad, but it's not Ibn Ziyad who wants it. It's one of his courtiers, a man called Ibn Abi Muhil, a nephew of al-Banin, who asks Ibn Ziyad, my nephews are on that field. And he means by that al-Abbas and his three brothers, the four sons of al-Banin. and he asks Ibn Ziyad to write a document that will give them safe passage off the field. Ibn Ziyad writes this document, it is taken to the brothers, and they reject it immediately because it does not include al-Hussein, but only al-Abbas and his three blood brothers. But there's a second offer of indemnity, and that is from Shimr, the terrible, monstrous killer on that battlefield, who is also, in the most bizarre way, related to al-Banin. And as the battle's about to begin, and shortly before or shortly after Ibn Ziyad's offer, Shimr comes and stands outside the tents and the encampment of al-Hussein, and he calls out for al-Abbas and his three brothers to step forward, and he offers them indemnity. He says, don't die with al-Hussein. I will give you safe passage off the field. And once again, often with al-Abbas as the spokesman, the four brothers utterly reject these two acts of indemnity. So the double indemnity is the first major feature of al-Abbas on the battlefield. Almost certainly, it seems, the indemnity came on the 9th of Muharram. Underline this because dating is very, very important if we're going to figure out what al-Abbas did. When did he go for water? This is a very difficult moment to date, but we're going to try to date it. It seems almost certainly that it was on the night of the 9th that this double act of indemnity or offer an indemnity came and was refused. On that same night, second point of al-Mufid, al-Hussein instructs al-Abbas to ride out to the enemy and find out what they want. This is because there has been a flurry of activity, diplomatic activity, between al-Hussein and the enemy. And suddenly, the enemy is on the move again. So al-Hussein sends his diplomat brother, al-Abbas, to find out what they want. The Arabic text says, what has changed? And it's very interesting. It's not just what are you doing, but what has caused you to change your mind? Because there seemed to be a point that there might have been a resolution, and quite clearly it hasn't worked. Now, this riding out is what I think is the first of the three major roles that al-Abbas will play on the field of Karbala, and they are the ones that are reported by all the Sunni historians. He goes with about 20 horsemen. That's a considerable size or proportion of al-Hussein's very tiny army. And when he gets to the enemy, he is offered a choice. Either al-Hussein must submit to Yazid and his authority, or they will be attacked. And al-Abbas successfully persuades these soldiers not to do anything until he's gone back and informed al-Hussein of the choice before him. And while he does this, some of his group begin to engage the enemy in a fascinating conversation. Now, we don't have time tonight to talk about that conversation, but it is an extraordinary moment when some of the followers of al-Hussein begin to challenge the members of the army while al-Abbas has gone back to talk to al-Hussein. Al-Hussein generally instructs al-Abbas to return and to delay the enemy further until the morning. The excuse that al-Hussein gives is that he and his companions might spend the night in prayer and Quranic recitation. Curiously, when al-Abbas does get back, that's not the reason he gives. He gives the suggestion that maybe al-Hussein wants to think over the proposal. This is al-Abbas at his best. I am convinced that he knew that the enemy would never accept the reason of prayer and Quran as a reason to delay, but they would delay if they thought that maybe al-Hussein was thinking about the proposal. There's a number of documents written about this because some people think that al-Abbas was acting on his own free will here without reference to al-Hussein. I'm not sure if that's true. I think al-Abbas here was being the diplomat. He was a very savvy man, and he knew the enemy well. And this is al-Abbas, for me, at his best. And so the delay is given. Al-Abbas's mission is a success, and the army of al-Hussein are left alone for that night, the 9th of Muharram. During that night, they do pray. because there is at least one of the texts of Atusi that says it sounded like the noise of bees buzzing, the prayer that was going on in the camp of Al-Hussein. But there's also the suggestion that Al-Hussein was able to give last orders and prepare his final testament and also speak to his family on that night. The third of Al-Mufid's great moments is still probably on the night of the 9th of Muharram, and that is the moment that Al-Hussein attempts, not for the first time, to dispense his followers from any oaths they have that bind them to him. And he basically gives them the freedom to leave. And he uses a marvelous ancient Arabic proverb about using the darkness like a camel to carry you away secretly. In a number of texts, but definitely not all texts, Al-Abbas is the first to stand and say, "We will do no such thing. Why would you think we would?" But although this is a very important moment in the life of Al-Abbas, very few of the texts actually have Al-Abbas as the spokesman. They simply say that his companions refused. So I have found and listed in my works those texts which highlight Al-Abbas as the spokesperson, because it's not the only time that he is the spokesperson. He's also the spokesperson in rejecting the double offer of indemnity. We're still on the night of the 9th of Muharram. Now, in the fourth moment of Al-Mufid's chronology, we move to the morning of the battle, early Friday, the 10th of Muharram. There are some authors who say it was a Saturday and some a Wednesday. No, it was almost certainly a Friday by most texts. On the morning of Friday, the 10th of Muharram, Al-Hussein mobilizes his forces and he gives his standard, his banner, to Al-Abbas. People may not understand how important the banner carrier was in the battle. Curiously, the enemy army gives their standard to an unknown warrior who disappears from history, but Al-Hussein gives it to his brother. And I think that after his diplomatic mission the night before to win time, this is the second major role of Al-Abbas at Karbala. He is the standard bearer, and as we will see, he doesn't ever let go of that standard. We have examples in Islamic history of others who did let go of the standard, but Al-Abbas holds the standard until the end. At this moment, there are two incidents that occur in Al-Abbas's life that Al-Mufid fails to record. The first is that Al-Hussein sends his eldest son, Ali Al-Akbar, and Al-Abbas to calm the women who have become alarmed by Al-Hussein's final farewell and his final sermon. And they have to be calmed down by these two men, sent specifically to do that by Al-Hussein. Curiously, Al-Mufid omits this moment, and he omits the next moment in which Al-Abbas is sent by Al-Hussein to rescue four of his men who have become trapped by the enemy. So these four men plunged deep into the battle and then found themselves trapped, and Al-Hussein sends Al-Abbas to rescue them. Al-Abbas does attempt to rescue them. They are all four of them quite badly wounded. In some texts, they refuse to be rescued and prefer to die fighting where they are. In other texts, they are brought back by Al-Abbas. But in any event, Al-Abbas does come back to inform Al-Hussein about the situation of these men. So you've had four moments recorded by Al-Mufid and then two extra moments that Al-Mufid then omits. The fifth chronological moment that Mufid offers us is after battle has been engaged. And in fact, almost certainly it's near the end of the battle when Al-Mufid finally returns to the figure of Al-Abbas. He puts the incident immediately after the dreadful death of Al-Hussein's youngest son, Abdullah, lying in his father's lap or lying in his father's arms. And immediately after that child is killed, Abu Bakr, son of Al-Hasan, is also killed. Now, here again, the chronologies differ depending which Maqatil work you're reading. But we're following Mufid here, so let's stay with Al-Mufid. When Al-Abbas sees that almost everyone has been killed, he calls his three blood brothers, and none of whom have any offspring, and he invites them to go ahead of him and to be martyred. He will then become their heir, and then he himself will go forward and be martyred. And again, it's quite a long incident. It's well recorded by the Sunni historians Tabari, Baladhuri, and others, as are all of these major events. And these three sons of al-Banin, and we're not sure which order they go in because the texts differ, but Uthman, Abdullah, and Abu Jaffa, and Jaffa, they go forward one by one, often reciting very powerful poetry, and each of them is martyred. It seems to me that these may have been the last three to die, leaving only Al-Abbas and Al-Hussein standing, but not every text would agree with that. See, this is now the point that Al-Mufid's chronology becomes a little difficult, and it becomes less detailed than most of the early Sunni historians. What Al-Mufid now says after the death of the three brothers of Al-Abbas is that Al-Hussein's thirst becomes so severe that he himself begins an attempt to get near water. He doesn't send Abbas, he tries himself to get either to the river itself or to a tributary of the river. Al-Abbas is with him, and in fact, in front of him, still holding the standard, having just lost his three blood brothers. But Umar bin Sa'd and his horsemen, they block access to the river because water has been blocked for a number of days. It's hard to know when it was finally blocked, but certainly from the 7th of Muharram, there was no access to water at all. It may well have been earlier. So these two men, the last two standing, are fighting their way to water. Al-Abbas is surrounded by the enemy. He is separated deliberately from Al-Hussein by the enemy. He single-handedly attacks the men around him, but he is easily outnumbered and he is killed. And the texts, most of them name the two men most responsible for his death. So in the eyes and the chronology of Al-Mufid, that is the end of Al-Abbas. But this attempt by Al-Hussein and Al-Abbas to get water at the end of the battle is told very differently by the earlier sources. So, what interests me in writing about Al-Abbas, although I use Al-Mufid, obviously, is what do the earliest texts say? And the earliest texts we have are really five historical works. And these five works were composed between the second century of Hijra and the fourth century of Hijra, the 8th to 10th century. And they are the five most trusted works about the Karbala event and the death of Al-Hussein. The first is the work by a man called Abu Mihnaf. Now, the problem is, Abu Mihnaf was apparently a Shia. Although he lived too early to be given that label, he was certainly a supporter of Ali bin Abi Talib and certainly part of the group that gravitated around Ali and his candidacy. But we don't have Abu Mihnaf's work anymore. It's long disappeared. What we have are fragments of Abu Mihnaf that have found their way into other very early historical works to a lesser or greater degree. So he is the first and the earliest work we have about the death of Al-Abbas at Karbala. Second is a Sunni, Ibn Sa'd. And Ibn Sa'd, in his famous Kitab al-Tabaqat, transmitted from a man called Al-Waqidi, who had Abu Mihnaf as his source, Ibn Sa'd also gives us a fair amount of information. The third is also a Sunni, and probably one of the most important, and that is Baladhuri. Baladhuri's history, his Kitab Ansab al-Ashraf, contains a maqtal work of al-Hussein. And he too is transmitting from sources who used Abu Mihnaf, and therefore he is quite reliable. Then there is a Sunni called Dinawari. He's also got a book called Reports of the Mighty, Kitab al-Akhbar al-Tiwal. And he certainly has information about Al-Abbas. And then a Shia, Ibn Atham. And Ibn Atham's book, Al-Futuh, contains a fair amount of information. So when I was writing my work on Al-Abbas, I chose two Sunni authors, both of whom transmitted from Abu Mihnaf. The one, of course, is Al-Balawri, the other is At-Tabari. And At-Tabari's Maqtal is really, for me, the most informative based on eyewitness events. But if you put all of the sources together, you have five possible ways in which the story of Al-Abbas trying to get water could be told. In the first place, the oldest theory we have, and this is the theory of Abu Mihnaf, Al-Baladhuri, Ibn Abi Adunya, Ad-Dinawari, At-Tabari, and then later Khawarizmi, who was not a Shia, but wrote a very beautiful Maqtal, and Ibn al-Athir, the Sunni historians. The oldest tradition is that on a day before the battle, and it could have been the 7th or the 8th or the 9th, Al-Abbas, with a group of soldiers, successfully managed to get water from the Euphrates and brought water skins back for al-Hussein and his companions. Now, they may have gone more than once. We don't know that. Some texts suggest that there was more than one attempt. But what we can establish is that, according to the earliest sources, on at least one occasion, somewhere between the 7th and the 10th, Al-Abbas and a group successfully managed to fight at the Euphrates and bring water back for Al-Abbas, for al-Hussein. Of course, that's not the story that's retold now in the Majalis tradition. It's a very different story, but that's the original story. There is a second strand found in Ibn Abi Dunya, which suggests that Al-Abbas was killed sometime at Karbala before al-Hussein, but it doesn't connect him to water at all. It simply suggests that he was killed while fighting, perhaps one of the last to die. So that's a very rare strand which I found, and it's not transmitted by many, but it is proposed by some very early authors. Then there's a third possibility, and this is first found in the 4th, 10th century. It's found in a text by an Ismaili scholar called Al-Qadi An-Nu'man, who writes a very, very long maqtal. It's also found in Sheikh al-Mufid and Ibn Ta'us. And the suggestion is the one we spoke about earlier, that Al-Abbas was killed just before al-Hussein, as together they went to reach water. There's a fourth possibility, and that is Al-Abbas was killed sometime on the day of Karbala itself, as he attempted to get water for al-Hussein. Probably not for al-Hussein's companions, most of whom were dead by then, but certainly for the women and the children. So this scenario is found in our Ismaili friend, Al-Qadi An-Nu'man, and it's found 2 centuries after him in the Sunni scholar Khawarizmi, and it's found, most important, in the very important Shi'i scholar Ibn Shahrashu. And it is the details of Ibn Shahrashub that you will find today mostly in the popular Majalis and Ta'ziyah recounting of the story. Told quite graphically that Al-Abbas fights his way to the water, carrying, in theory, carrying in one hand the standard and in one hand his sword, and somewhere else on his person, one or more water skins. He manages to fight off those at the water and then fills his skins and then begins this impossible journey back to al-Hussein. And the journey is made impossible by the fact that he is outnumbered by all these soldiers who are going to prevent him. And according to the text of Ibn Shahrashub, he loses both hands in the attempt. He loses, I think, first his left hand, but then we're not sure where his sword was. Some say he kept his sword in his mouth, but then we also noticed despite the fact that he's bleeding profusely and he's lost both his hands. And it seems at this stage the water skins are on his body, perhaps around his neck and hanging on his body. They themselves are pierced by arrows, and so he loses all his water, and then seemingly still holding the banner, which he never lets go of, he is struck by somebody using a flagpole and is toppled from his horse, and then he is killed. Now, that scenario of this lonely figure, without anyone supporting him, still carrying the banner, although at least one text says he plants the banner in the ground, but most of them say he carries the banner, he gets to water, single-handedly fills his water skins, and then is devastatingly wounded on his way back and finally killed so that the water never arrives. This is the most popular account, but I have to say it's not the earliest account. It's not the account of Abu Mihnaf, the first Shia scholar. Could I just add that there is a final possibility, and it is found in a much more contemporary maktal. It's a maktal by Abdurrazzaq, and his maktal simply suggests that Al-Abbas would have gone more than once for water. If the water was cut off around the seventh, if not earlier, then there would have been more than one attempt to get water in those three devastating days, even on the day of the battle. And so there is the possibility that Al-Abbas went the night before and also died trying again to get water for Al-Hussein and for the women and for the children. He is buried, he lies buried, and I will finish with this thought because it's a moving thought. Al-Abbas, of course, lies buried where he fell on the banks of the Euphrates. The curious thing is that over time, the course of the Euphrates has changed, and it is now much closer to the tomb of Al-Abbas than it was when he was first buried, suggesting that the Euphrates has now come back to him, who first went to the river to rescue water for Al-Hussein. I am writing this book and almost finished this book for a number of reasons. Firstly, because I enjoy researching these figures around Al-Hussein at Karbala, but more especially because I remain convinced that these lives, not just Al-Hussein, but also Al-Abbas, the Lady Zainab, Lady Fatima, all of the others gathered around Al-Hussein from his birth until his death, their stories need to be told to a Western audience to show the models of Islamic bravery and piety, the models of utter faithfulness to the revelation that had been received. The fact that it was not just in the Christian West, but also in the Islamic East, that men and women were willing to lay down their lives for the tenets of God's revelation. But in Al-Abbas's case, to willing to lay down his life for others. He goes to fetch water, not just for Al-Hussein, but for the companions and for the women and the children. In the most popular narratives, we have the Lady Sakina begging him for water, and he is so devastated by her thirst that this exceptional warrior is willing to fight his way through impossible odds just to get water, not for himself, but for her. There's a famous picture of Al-Abbas standing in the river, dying of thirst himself, but flinging the water down before he tastes it, because he will not drink before Al-Hussein and his companions have drunk. And therefore, for me, he is a model of utter selflessness in a very egotistical world in which we're living. He is an icon of what it means to give up your own rights so that the rights of others may be seen to be done. He didn't have to do any of this, but he did it because this is his character. He was, by all accounts, a very large man, so large that when he rode his horse, his feet would drag on the ground. He would be what today we would call a gentle giant, a man of such tenderness towards those in need, and yet such valor that he's not able only to undertake extremely dangerous diplomatic missions for his brother, but also this almost fatal mission to fetch water from the river. So I thank you for giving me this time to talk about somebody to whom I've become very attached. And I hope to publish this book soon. And I hope that it will provide for Western, not necessarily religious people, not necessarily Muslim readers, but simply for Western readers, another glimpse into why al-Hussein and his struggle and the stand he took was so important, but more importantly, to see the sort of lives that al-Hussein and his stand shaped among his companions. And I look forward perhaps to talking to you again sometime in the future. So thank you.